very good afternoon, everyone, and I'm delighted to be here. Thanks to Crescon for having this discussion today. So digital transformation is really the way forward for pretty much each and every one of you who is sitting over here, whether we are in running SMEs or whether we are actually part of a big corporate overview. And I mean, some of the data that I was reading, which was a global data, which said that nearly 89% of organizations are today in trying to deploy digital transformation, which primarily implies that a digital architecture for your organization. And it's only about 40 or 44%, in fact, was the real number, which has got or been able to achieve small to moderate amount of success with this digital transformation. So I think we are still, if somebody out there is feeling that they have been left out of digital transformation base, I don't think there's any reason to feel like that, because the data has just started, so to say. And there's still very little work that has been done, the tip of the iceberg has been touched, and I think it's only going forward that the real transformation and results and what works and what doesn't work is going to really kind of going to come to us in a big way. But indeed, traditional industries today feel the need, not just from the point of catching up with the rest of the world, but more even from the dent of the revenue, the operations, whether it is marketing or whether it is HR or whether it is finance and how it has to be controlled, all today needs to be more mechanized, more needs to be more digitized. So I think digitization is really more of a commercial function than a technical function. And therefore the whole alignment of everybody in the organization towards this goal is becoming more and more critical. So, you know, the marketing department cannot be running disaligned from the technology department, and the technology department cannot be disaligned from the finance department. The HR in its entirety have to adopt digital landscape in order to be successful. If one department does it and the others don't, its success is going to be very less or negligible in order. So I think you've got Prasanna here and you've also got Uttam here from KFC, who've actually been for 5 years, not just in India, but across the global organization setup, where they have been the first ones to experiment with what digitization or tomorrow's digitization is going to be for their organization. So let's just start with you, Prasanna. Banks are probably, as far as banks go, and the need for banks to really go on a digital mode was probably when, as I as a editor first came across back in 2012 or 2013, where banks were starting or beginning to talk about fintech and how it could get completely disrupted by it. And traditional banking was getting the creeps of not being able to sort of maintain its branch and customer involved system as it used to be. So at BCB, you were the first ones as a bank to sort of go in for open adoption of digital innovation. So what exactly, I mean, now it's, we're almost talking about 6 or 7 years down the line, we look at what has this digital landscape been for you all about? What was it that you first achieved? What was it that worked for you in this architecture? What is it that, you know, you as a bank have been able to enhance the user experience?
Very interesting question you asked. What is your digital transformation strategy? And I thought I could explain in a short time. So, coming back, long back when I opened my first bank account, and I was so happy to open my bank account after 30 days. And I must have referred that bank to several of my friends to open the bank account or bank account from this bank, my relatives and all.
What year was
it? It was like 2000. And if I asked, same bank, or if same bank will offer me, okay, instead of 30, 29 days, still I will say, your bank is not relevant, your bank is not digital, or you are not really hearing the customer's voice. This is what I will say. Even in my bank also, we say that 25 days, 20 days, it's not an actual output of account opening. So now, every organization is transforming themselves to the next orbit. So new banks are already into that orbit now to look at how they can leverage on the new architecture, new people to get to actual customer, better customer. Like bank like us with a legacy of 85-year-old bank, then now you can imagine ki what type of systems are already there. And on top of that, now you are talking about digital and keeping that interest of new customers as well as existing customers. So primarily when it is to open a bank account, like it's just an opening a bank account, I don't know then what happens to the consumer later on to the account and the finances, transactions and so on. So now customers are becoming very hyper-personalized. They want everything there and there itself. So that becomes the responsibility of the bank also. If I am opening this bank account in 4 minutes or there and itself, just like an example, Kotak, they have done some kind of innovation or a DBS bank has done something. But what is after that? Whether he is my primary customer, after, even after opening a bank account so fast. So that's the one another way to look at is after opening a bank account or onboarding a customer, engage them with the services. So serving a customer is a health issue, like you have to give all the type of services. But how do we keep the engaged consumer on the same app? He has to come again and again to the transaction and should not go to the another bank. As well as look at how he is performing on the other apps or everywhere, wherever he goes. So I think it's very important for any organization, not only bank, who are serving the consumers, to understand them. Where do they go? Like on how many times they watch a movie at the weekend? So can I offer something else to my banking app? So it means like not only from the experience which I was having with NEFT, RTGS or doing normal mini statement and so on, I had to go beyond that. So it's like a model of everyday banking. It means from morning to evening, gets up till he sleeps, whatever he is doing, I need to understand what he is doing. And I have to give back those services. So then only he will be loyal to my app. So it could be non-banking experience, it could be a social cause experience and so on. Provided the data security is concerned, everything is taken care of. So this is how the next landscape banks will look at.
Right.
So as Bill Gates says, many understand that banks are not important, but banking experience has to be there. And as now consumers are moving away from the branch, although Bharat or rest of the Indians, they always go to the branches. But typically looking at the future, you have to take care of branch, internet banking, mobile banking. But now consumer sitting here wants to order food, wants to do the transaction there and there, or wherever he goes in a branch or in a shopping mall, he wants to know what's happening now, everything around him. So I think from a one-directional channels, it is coming out the bi-directional as well as a unidirectional. So while sitting in here, I will have to have a branch office for some time out there, which can be an AR/VR experience or some kind of another experience. And it's like you have to keep on understanding what consumer is doing on a single transaction and give back those bi-directional experience. So ultimately when consumer is coming to you, he was doing one transaction. But bi-directionally, what exactly I can offer him with the help of big data or AI algorithms. That's another way to look at it. Now, when I know consumer is very important, apart from the traditional channels, he is going everywhere, sharing economy, like he is doing regional some hotels, or he is going for trip or trips or tourist trip. So he is everywhere and the sharing economy is evolving. Apart from having currently very few entities are there on sharing economy, your car, Ola or OYO, you will find 400-500 entities in the future now. So you have to aggregate this. So as a single bank, I cannot do it. So when I want to do it, I have to leverage on those APIs or those technologies which will help to bring my experience to those experiences of those channels. So that's the solution. If I ask my IT department, let's deliver these systems. So they will be able to do it, but by the time other banks and other components will move ahead and will deliver it. So how to really manage this game, right? So you have to again partner with those fintech companies who will give the agile output within a defined time with a very good experience, and customer is glued to that. So banks are now bringing that architecture which open up their banking services to APIs to these fintechs or to the front-end channels. So it could be my own front-end channel like mobile banking, or partner with some apps like PhonePe or Swiggy and BookMyShow. So it means I am providing my bank out there on those channels and consumer is utilizing it.
Do you think even for fintechs, the way forward is to think like an enterprise tech enterprise?
Absolutely, it's a collaboration game.
Yeah, it's a
collaboration game, and you cannot say that I'm a bank and I will sell all my customer on my own.
Yeah.
Because customer is having different varieties, and today we are living in a generation where there are 6 to 8 types, 7 types of generations, and every generation demands your experience in different ways. somebody wants to go to the branches, somebody wants in hand, somebody wants to be sitting and I want to order to Alexa. So you have to serve those consumers everywhere. And as an IT system within a bank, you can deliver retail in a 1 year or different. When you partner more, with the same API, you can go to the different fintech partners. And you can cover up more. So it was a beautiful journey, bringing this transformation with an organization where these people are not there in the organization who understand what is my API.
Right.
And then bring people, identify which process to bring on those systems, build those ESPs and APIs and deliver another business model to have a fintech adoption. So that's how we did this exercise last 3-4 years. And here on it's really giving good outputs.
Sure.
Okay,
what are the omnichannel initiatives that KFC has taken, and what are some of these initiatives that have worked best for you? Now, this could be like your click and connect model, self-service kiosks that you might be looking at. And I think delivery is probably the, I would say, the elephant in the room for everyone, that everybody is trying to track in the food industry.
No, absolutely. I think delivery has literally actually disrupted the entire business. But I think overall, coming back to omnichannel, I think we are following like a KFC everywhere strategy, where you would want that customer can order KFC anytime, anywhere, and in the preferred channel of choice they want. And whether it could be ordering on the app and checking the order status on your Alexa, it could be just chatting and putting an order on Facebook Messenger, or ordering on the website and coming in the store to pick up, or ordering in the store and then eating the food at home. So all that, I think, in terms of omnichannel strategy, I think is a big part of our strategy. In terms of what has worked and what has not worked, I think in terms of within the food, I think the most prevalent is obviously the app, as you said, the delivery, app, using app for delivery, the ordering through M-site and website. Some of the other innovations like kiosk and click and connect, I would say, I think they are fairly nascent in India, so yet. I think globally, obviously, a lot of the markets, as we see, France, UK, Australia, US, they're very invested heavily in kiosk, and I think for some of the markets it has worked, primarily because of impact on the ticket price. There is actually a theory which says that if you're looking for comfort food and if you order the kiosk, then actually you will actually end up ordering more. Because nobody judges, they'll judge you on how much cheese sizes you're adding on your food, right? So, but in India, I think it's a fairly nascent, I know some of our competitors have already started experimenting. When are we doing it? Yes, it's in, we will be there shortly. Other things like click and collect, obviously that is a big one, I think the fact that everything consumer wants everything on their device, right? They don't really want to be standing in the line. They don't, if you go on a Sunday evening, there's like 15 minutes of waiting time, everybody's shouting. That's something we want to basically overall reduce the friction of the consumer in the store. And we believe click to collect or click to order, all these variations of takeaway essentially channel, I think they are going to be very important for us. So we are working on that, consumers will see it shortly.
So I think India is more like a click and deliver economy, right?
Yes, yes.
And then you also wanted to come where you are.
No, apparently takeaway is a large part of the business. What we do find in consumer research, actually takeaway is a big part which doesn't really surface up as a channel in terms of the popularity, but indeed actually it is. And a lot of the aggregators are actually experimenting with that as well. So I'm sure, I think after delivery, this probably could be one of the other growth engines for the food players in India.
Idea is really make it the takeaway more efficient.
Yeah, so it can work, right? All the consumer research that we're doing, and it's very common when you start from office on a Friday evening and you know that super wala chicken tikka you want, and you call the guy and ki tikku yaar wo pack karke rakhna main aa raha hu abhi, that sort of thing, right? So and then the guy comes on the to the main street and hand it over, right? So and then you want to go and sit in back and relax in your home environment. So I think that actually occasions in QSR is quite prevalent. Now a lot of the big QSRs are also, obviously, we also want to cash in on that. So click and collect will be an endeavor to that, where you just order from your food, and as soon as you, let's say, within your 100 meters of our store zone, we actually start preparing the food and serve you hot. So that is
And you know, KFC has always been also been one of the first ones in the restaurant sector at least to take an initiative in artificial intelligence.
Right.
So whether it was use of chatbots or you know, sort of training Alexa to order for KFC.
So how
did this come to happen? I mean, you know, being first in the space and then also trying to achieve some success after.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, see, KFC, obviously, I would say QSR in general is a bit of a late entrant to the digital party, I would say. I mean, if you compare versus DCB versus QSR, I think we are definitely a few years behind. Now, but I think we're trying to leapfrog, and there are multi-dimensional strategy around why, it's a three-dimensional strategy that we're following, while we obviously want to work on our core systems, putting all the, as you said, open architecture in place to be able to integrate with third parties like the cities and the matter of the world. There is a transformational layer which is all about ORMs and CRMs of the world to make sure our customers, we know our customers well. And then there is a exploratory layer as well, which is all about Alexas and chatbots and AI ML, doing the recommendation engines and everything. So I think we are following that strategy, and I think we want to balance it out. I don't think we can be in a position where everything follows chronologically, right? We don't want to be wait for our systems to be upgraded to actually try Alexa. So our strategy has, we're trying to balance all of that, and I think our belief is that fail fast and learn fast. So we want to really experiment these technologies and really understand what is the real worth of them for us. I mean, I'll take an example of chat and voice, right? So initially, I think our belief was that it is going to be, it could be like a big ordering engine for us, right? Where people actually come on these devices and order. Actually, now we're learning that actually it is not maybe entirely true, right? I think it could be more like a user interface. Let's say, we've launched a smoky head recently as a new product, right? So I hope some people have tried it here. So it's a very nice product, you should go and try it. So smoky red, right? So now people don't understand what smoky red is, right? Or I want to understand what are the new offers are there, and I want to understand how do you cook chicken, what are the uniqueness of KFC chicken. I just want to interact with the brand, and these tools probably are more of that branding interface and then with an option of ordering as well. So that's the learning. So I think the philosophy that we have is that while we fix our core, let's actually even also explore and experiment with the technology so that actually by the time we are ready with the code, we actually already in a, we already have a learning curve to take it to the next level.
So one of the things I think I would love to know is that both at DCP as well as KFC, and you said that you're the late entrant in the party. I mean, I think it's also a cultural issue over here that you're trying to address. There is a certain set of employees, and unless you want to really hire all of them, you get an entirely new set of people coming in. There is a lot of changeover that needs to happen from everybody, as I said initially. How is it that you're achieving that? How is it that you're trying to get everybody on the same page to be able to?
No, it's a journey for every organization, is a different thing. Like I said, new banks, new architecture, new people, they know their agenda, why they are there, and how they want to serve a certain set of consumers. Old banks or PSU banks, the way they serve, and now another fintechs or new banks are coming, how they compete. So they have their own journey. Looking at our own journey, we found that we need some of the good champions who talk about digital, who experiment and showcase those results to the top management, board members, so that they understand this is how we have the capacity or capability we can really build. So I think mindset change happens with a slow education to the top and bring down that to the your branch staff and so on. So whatever we deliver, we go on the field and teach those new things to the branch staff also, so that they can convert or ask customers to adopt it. It's not only delivering open banking, or it's not only delivering a mobile app, but after that journey it starts. How the consumer will come on top of that. Like suppose you want to experiment on blockchain, AI, or any new technology on variables, or AR where experience to branch. So first of all, you have to show some experiment to the branch, board members or management committee, and bring that kind of a investment to these experiments. So I think change that mindset, you always have to involve top management, and it has to be the agenda of the board members also. What is that innovation or digital strategy? So now our organizations are understanding that they should have a separate entity within our organization who takes care of only digital or innovation. Earlier it was only IT director or CTO, but now they are getting how do we partner with the startup fintech, so they are bringing on innovation or fintech departments. So how do we do on the blockchain or emerging techs? So within a organization, so they are reskilling those people. So reskilling is another way to look at how existing employees can be used. And tomorrow if I want to transform or do the process automation or robotic process automation of the same process, so involve the same guy who is doing that operation, so that his role is kept safe as well as he is become a champion in that area. So it's a way to look at optimizing your organizations, not only with the technology but mindset. So there comes role of HR, so it may be possible that your KRA it should be changed.
So, but the HR itself is, their hands are too tight. They have not gone the era of robotic transformation.
But I think then, if the organization will not change, then there are the other organizations who are already changed will cover those organizations. So it's very important for every organization how they go to the next level. And it's very important for a top management to understand where we are, in which organization we are sitting. And while to go to the next orbit, you have to take care of people, what process you have to change, which technology we should adopt immediately, and ultimately take care of regulation, cyber security, and what is that consumer's demand, then we'll be able to be succeed.
Sure. What is your personal take?
So I think, see, culturally, so two things I would say, right? One is the bottoms up and both the top down. I think that aspect is really important, that bottoms up, you actually have to build trust of the organization in the stuff that you're doing, and obviously results are important in that, whether it's branding or whether it's actual money that comes in. So building that trust that whatever we talk about, we actually deliver on time with high quality. I think once the cross-functional leaders actually start believing that, seeing that you're a credible partner, that you're actually bringing the right technologies with the right cost and the right outputs to them, I think that actually makes a big change. I think organizations are struggling with digital versus IT operating models, but I think as long as your business access is growing and it's consistent, it's not getting impacted, and you're actually generating incremental business benefits, whether it's, as I said, money or branding, I think then actually that is very important. And obviously then top down also, I think that is very important, because if your CEO or the board is not behind that digital agenda, I don't think you can actually be successful. And I mean, good part of that actually now the consumer in general is becoming so savvy, right? I mean, I go into quarterly updates, and you wouldn't imagine that every board member or every C person in the room is actually giving us feedback on what should be better on the app in terms of the UX. So he said, "Nahi, aise flow, aise kar do, isse achha ho jayega, humne wahan dekha tha." So I think that is actually good part, because now even like all 50, 50, 60, board members are actually also that savvy, as a consumer, that actually they believe that if their organization is not in that top league of, providing the digital customer experience, and will be behind. So I think both of them are actually very important to be able to succeed.
Another area I would like to touch is about cybersecurity, especially as a user sometimes. I mean, that clients, they are the most vulnerable when it comes to protecting the customer data. And hackers have always been smarter than technology builders. It's a given. So, as a client, what are the initiatives that you are taking to ensure that in the digitalization process, the customer is safe, the customer's data is safe, his account is safe, and hacking is probably as controlled as possible?
So I think cybersecurity is very important agenda, not only banks, but wherever a consumer is there. So that is why in India we have a separate cell for cybersecurity. Even the RBI takes care of cybersecurity very well. So they have started RBI IT examinations last year, and everywhere they are doing it. So as you rightly said, hackers are always ahead. So what is that which will help us to not to have those hacks and so on? We have seen some of the recent examples in one bank in Pune or cooperative banks, as well as in 2 years before, 30 lakhs cards were schemed in India also. So, so best thing is to do create robust systems as well as educate your consumers as well as employees. So, as a part of this separate cyber security as an initiative, so maybe 3 years, 4 years, because we were having only 2 or 3 guys in IT security. So today we have more resources, more skilled resources on separate area network security. We have our own software to monitor threats on 24/7. So technologically we are keeping ourselves ready, as well as any product we move out, so we do proper investigation as well as do the required test, vulnerability or assessment, as well as on a regular basis we assess our environment, networks and so on. And on a regular basis we do educate our employees, and that particular pitch goes from the top management. He will stand and will talk about what are the ways people hack, what are different hacks happened in a country or globally, and how organization is ready for that. And furthermore, what is your responsibility here on? Take example, you should not open up any of the emails or the links in the email, even if it is coming from MD. You just have to really read which is that domain. But there are different ways of phishing and social hacking. There are those kind of hand-holding we do with the employees. Because at least 90-95% hacking happens because of some mistakes done deliberately or some involvement of internal people. Like somebody is putting USB, which is not should not be allowed. So these small things we keep on explaining them. And as well as while we deliver any of the products, so how secure it should be the product. We bring on those controls either through biometric, voice, or a consumer to operate those products, mobile banking and so on. And keep educating consumer through the employees who have got education on the cyber security. Because as you rightly said, hackers are always ahead, so you have to keep those tightening those educational aspects. So I think that's a main agenda which we are driving. And banks always sit in a glass houses. Any small fraud happens, it becomes a reputation risk for us. So it's very important for us before going live. We have to really keep it safe. We may at times do this ethical hacking also on our apps. And once we certify, we are quite confident enough, okay, this is an hack-proof app. But it's a journey, and hackers are always ahead. And we have to keep tightening our networks and the areas where physical security, logical network security, and keep educating employees as a part of an infection, what they do, what they do not do, so that whole periphery is secure.
Correct. You have a
cyber security, yes. So cyber security is also, it's very important in QSR as well, largely two perspectives. First, because of all the customer data that we have, and the second is the reputation risk. I mean, for us also, it is becoming a global agenda now. There are a lot of trainings and guidelines, and we can't. Everything has to be certified by designated vendors, which is globally appointed. So a lot of focus on cyber security, as I said, largely to the reputation risk that is involved.
Sure.
Do
we have time for questions?
Please.
See, it is being said in the world that any digital transformation process is essentially a process of change management. It has to change your people, your process, your policy, strategy, structure, and finally the competitive dynamics. Now, all these changes in your planning process cannot be possible to be achieved in first go when you are in the drawing board. If you have to go back to the drawing board for the second time, it becomes a very cost-involving process. So my question to both the panel members is, what are your directional guidelines for a company to be successful in digital transformation for these 6 items, people, process, policy, strategy, structure, and competitive dynamics?
I think directions or detailed framework. So as you rightly said, initial 3 aspects which we looked at is the people, process, technology, and as well as one more, another regulation and the external partners, and ultimately at the consumers. So people transformation, do we have like quick example of, I want to transform my organization, bring on some technology like AI or blockchain. So I need to really see what is that needed. Like, do you have that kind of a skill set or people available in the organization? If not, either I rescale internal people or bring on new people. And creating the right governance, and after creation of right governance, identify which are the processes we go on that or which are the use cases. Certainly I can bring a crypto back. Without I can change complete UPI or complete financial ecosystem, but does that the right use case? Or does that the right person have to change? So look at what are the primary benefits points to my consumers, whatever investment which I have done so far on people process, and what I want as a business partner for the consumer. If it is achieving through the adoption of blockchain, I will do that. But either already I had heavily invested on UPI and this thing, I will not. I will do something which is an experience where blockchain is not included. I will do it somewhere trust is required, and some process like in debt finance where ad hoc, or some process in reconciliation, which is a part of a financial system, where identification of right use case as a priority, and build those small POCs and with the blockchain technology or some other RPA technologies, and then get into does that regulation is supporting or not. I would say tomorrow I come up with a solar coin or a Bitcoin or another Bitcoin. But regulation says it's not supported, at least in the Indian context. But regulation always says that blockchain is supported. So bring on the right set of use case in align with the regulation, and ultimately see whether what process I am changing, whether it is helpful for my internal or external consumers. So to suggest to support you that strategy, I will look at these five things, like right? People, process, technology, regulation, and partnering, and finally consumer as an actor. So partnering, as I say, while partnering also a lot of policies and a lot of frameworks I have to create with the partnering with the fintechs, which was not available earlier. So partnering with the fintech, not only technical partnership, but whether that fintech is going to sustain for next 3 years. So these are the new things that are now coming up. So just to support you, sir, like transformation is a journey like changing your engine while you are driving your, rather driving, flying your aeroplane. So it's a very difficult journey. But when complete organization has the same agenda, so it becomes so easy, and we have seen that.
Vipin, would you like to throw some light on competitive dynamics to be successful through digital transformation?
Yeah, so I think I would actually one element of the competitive dynamics would be consumer. I think so. If I will change a little bit, I'd say the consumer angle of it, right? So I think when we are choosing digital technologies and implementing those digital technologies and the pace of it. Actually, we are also thinking about whether our consumer will be able to absorb that change or not, right? So, for example, if I'm, let's say, today I'm actually, let's say, launching two more channels, right? I launched Lex already, now we're thinking of two more. So, we're trying to actually space it out that actually it is not something which the consumers can't absorb, because otherwise, the consumers can't, internalize and absorb that level of pace of change that is coming from the brand. Then that change is of no use either, right? And obviously, competitive dynamics, obviously, I mean, I don't think we actually look that much that, okay, so much power and X competitor has done this now, actually. It's not a race for us, it's not a FOMO that we follow. But it's more, I think, everybody has their own journey, as long as, we are actually, because stepping back, I mean, KFC is actually, doesn't have a direct competitive product, right? We are actually competing on the share of wallet, right? So when we choose technologies, we choose what's best for us and our consumers, which will actually bring more business and create incremental transactions to us. So competitive dynamics, yes, in a way it is there, but there are some areas we can win, there are some areas we can't. So we don't keep that much as a lens when we choose digital technology.
Yeah.
To a certain extent, yes, but not entirely. Because, it depends also, right? So it could be that my competitor X is actually investing very heavily on the back of the house to digitize the inventory management and all the cooking that is happening or the auditing that is happening. Right? So it depends on where they are in the journey, right? So what? From our perspective, we have to see where we are in the journey. Right? If I'm a late entrant or already I'm already ahead of the curve, then I have to choose what's best for me, for my consumer, and where I want to put my eggs on. So, because as I said, we are competing with the share of the wallet, not exactly on the product competition.
Do we have time for more questions?
No, I'm sorry, time's up.
Okay. Due to the paucity of time, we'll not take more questions. But I think that was a great answer, and I think as global organizations, probably you've taken the first mover advantage of bringing that innovation architecture within your organizations to bring the change that the digital world today requires. So, as entrepreneur media, we're always happy to sort of hear about stories that are changing the business and the way it is being conducted and how the customer is going to be benefited eventually by all of this. And you know, I guess as we go forward, years, they probably not just do, but we have many more digital changes and transformations and this is becoming clear. Thank you very much for joining this panel and lovely talk.
Thank you very much, Manus.